Well, good morning and welcome to Church Without Walls. We've been thinking of you all this week with the cold and the snow and the weather. The pictures look absolutely gorgeous, don't they? But for many of you to go outside is treacherous and dangerous. And we've been praying that you've had safety, and we've been praying also that you've been able to keep yourselves nice and warm.
And we want to say welcome to Church Without Walls. Isn't it exciting that we're in church together this morning? And this morning we're going to have communion. We're going to have communion together. So if you want to get things ready, please do that now so you're all ready when we're taking communion. If you've got some wine or some juice or some bread, then you be ready. And also, many of you have written to me asking about different hymns and worship songs that you'd like us to play on Church Without Walls. Well, we're going to try each week to try and play some of the ones that you like. But today we put a medley of three together just for our opening time of worship.
I think this is really going to wake you up this morning, if you're not already wide awake. We've got "The Trumpet of the Lord Shall Sound." Let's pray together, shall we? Lord, we just want to come into your presence this morning. We want to experience you in a way that is so real and meaningful, yeah, and just helps us in our everyday lives to be able to live as you want us to, mm, and unto you. And so, Father, we pray that in this time that we're together, that you'll just give us opportunity of listening and receiving from you. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. They were certainly a lovely selection of
I know, and
there,
it? They evoke so many memories, and I'm sure that's what they'll do for you as viewers. And isn't it wonderful the way God can speak through songs and hymns and ones that we've heard from years and years ago, and they'll evoke a memory in us.
Well, things like when the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, those folks who've grown up in Pentecostal churches will have sung that one, the Salvation Army, I can think. And then, of course, we come to Just As I Am, and you think of all the Billy Graham crusades and just seeing the people responding to the claims of Christ. Amazing, yeah, amazing songs. Well, we often think, you know, we wonder what kind of situations you're in when you're watching Church Without Walls. And for some of you this morning, it may be that you're still in bed, maybe not because you want to be, but because you have to be because of sickness or age. Some of you may be sitting in your chairs, coffee cup beside you or cup of tea. Others of you, it may be absolutely hectic around you with all the toys and the children and the noise. But whatever your situation, our prayer today is that there might still be a stillness and a quietness as you just listen and hear from the Lord. We're going to be talking a little later on about resting in the Lord's presence and visions. That's really what we're wanting, just to allow God to speak,
yeah,
isn't it?
Yeah, and just when I was praying before we started, that verse of that hymn came me, let thy still dews of quietness and all your striving cease, take away the strain and stress, and let your ordered life confess the beauty of his peace. Mm. That just came to me as we were praying before the service began.
Well, may you know peace today, even in the turmoil of what may be going on around you in your home. And of course, we love joining Church Without Walls to hear from you and to be able to share news and particularly items to pray together. And some of you, even before we've announced, have already been emailing and texting in. Bless you. Even before our program began today, I'd received news from Kathleen in Derry in Northern Ireland. And Kathleen said, could we please pray for her friend Pat, who's in hospital? She's about to start dialysis. And Kathleen herself suffers from carpal tunnel, which is a form of arthritis, isn't it? Mm-hmm. And she says, I'm not getting much sleep. I've been on the waiting list since last May and hasn't even seen a consultant yet.
Dear, dear.
Wow. Well, Kathleen, we certainly later on want to be praying. And Ken and Margaret say, we're looking forward to another great program this morning. Our granddaughter Bethany is not with us today. A couple of days ago, she had to have her tonsils out.
Oh.
And she says, Bethany has contacted us to ask for Church Without Walls. Pray for her this morning. She's 11 years old and she's feeling sore. I can imagine she's feeling
sore. So we'll be praying for Bethany.
But we certainly need to be doing that. I may save her praying for Doug. And we will too. And here's just a very simple one, Lorna. It says, please can you pray for me so that I can start following the Lord?
Yeah, we'll definitely do that. No name.
No name on that one, but we'll be praying for you, whoever you are. Well, I believe that God wants to speak into each one of our hearts and give us direction and purpose and just guide us in the way that we could go. And you found a story of Heidi Baker, didn't you, where she talks about hearing from God.
Well, that's right, and it's just her vision, and I believe that God has a plan for all of us. It's not, you're not sidelined in any way. No one is sidelined with God. We're all special to him. And here we see Heidi Baker with a vision.
Jesus is good. Do you know that Jesus is good? He's good. He's good. Do you know that Jesus is good?
I had a vision. I had a vision that changed my life, and I'll never be the same. I saw hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of thousands of children, and I thought, I don't want to see this. And I started screaming out loud, no, no. And then Jesus showed up. He looked at me with those eyes of love, those burning, shandai, burning, passionate, fiery eyes of love, just like, and he looked at me and everything just changed. He looked at me and he said, there's always enough because I died. There's always enough because I died. This little girl taught me what love looks like. She taught me what love and mercy looks like. I know what this little girl does. You know, she has to sell her body, her one-legged body to eat. She sells her one-legged body to get a piece of bread. She sells her one-legged body, her one-legged 10-year-old body to drink a Coca-Cola. You know, this is like, somebody stop for one. Somebody, you know, this little girl is suffering out here. Like, the pain in her was incredible. And grandmother's a witch doctor. So when the house burned down and her leg burned off, grandmother said to the two older brothers, go out to the field and kill Helena. Kill her, stone her, because she's of no use to us. She's no value to us. She has no leg. So the brothers go out to the field and they throw rocks at her head and they think that she's dead. They think she's dead, but she's not. And she's lying there, bloody, broken, dying. This is so much. It's so clear. You can read the gospel and you can read it, and if you just talk to people and you don't understand that love looks like something, and you just say to Elena, I'm so sorry that happened to you. What a cruddy mess of a life you have. And you don't say to her, come home and live with me. Then love is it. I don't know what love is if it doesn't look like something. And one day, after a while, she just looks at me and she goes, Mama, I want to go home. And I thought, no way. My first reaction was, no way, no way, no. I just said, no, no, you're not going back to that home. That's the most dysfunctional family that I've ever heard of, and I know a few. You know, it's like that one, no. And she said, what do you mean? Do you think you told me about grace? She said, you said Jesus forgives. You said Jesus loves. You said Jesus loves. You said love looks like something. You said mercy. She said, how can I not go home and tell my family about Jesus? How can I not go home and tell them about love? I just pray for radical love to just rock this generation, God. I ask you for love to just come in and stretch every heart, God. Show them what love looks like, God. Show them what love looks like, God. That they would just go out to the darkest places. They would go to the brothels. They would go to the drug dens. They would go to the streets. They would go to the villages. They would go to the universities, and they would stop for the one. And they would stop for the one every single day of their life. Not complicated. It's just stop for the one.
What a woman. What an amazing story. She heard and she ran with what God had called her.
And she's right. Love has to be something. It just can't be words. And I'm sure you've been challenged, as I was, just watching that. We've got to let the love of God flow through us and right through us so others that can see Jesus. And when we pray, we can pray for light to go in the brothels. We can pray for the light of God to go on the streets. As we pray, God alters situations, but you have to pray.
That's right. And when she went to Mozambique, she had no idea what God had got for her. But within a period of 2 years, she got a little orphanage, and 80 children came into it. And today, she's got secondary schools and primary schools and orphanages dotted around and feeding programs. And God has just taken her and multiplied it. And I suppose what we need to understand, Lorna, is it's the same principle for us. Mm. For every one of us, God has got a plan and a purpose.
Yeah.
And who knows what it is? It may be the neighbour next door. It may be the little school group down the road. I don't know what it is.
No. But it's that seed of faith, isn't
right.
it? The seed of faith, and that seed of faith will grow from an acorn into an oak tree if you surrender your all to Jesus.
And so we want to encourage you today to just spend time aside, seek God and say, Lord, what's the purpose for my life in my situation? God will show you. And then we want to encourage you to run with it. Well, in a few moments, we're going to come and share communion together. You may never, ever have had communion in your own home. Maybe you've something you've only ever done in church. We just want to encourage you to find a piece of bread or a cracker or a biscuit or something, and to find a cup and put some wine or juice or even water into it, so that together as a body of Christ, we can share communion. So Lorna, let's, with all of our viewers at home, let's just share together in the Lord's Prayer, shall we?
Lovely.
Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Hear our prayer. We are your children, and we've gathered here today as we've gathered here to pray. Hear our cry. Lord, we need your mercy and we need your grace today. Yes, we do. Hear us as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Us from heaven, forgive our sins, we pray. Hear our song as it rises to heaven. May your glory fill the earth as the waters cover the sea. See our hearts and remove anything that is standing in the way of coming to you today. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Our Father, hear our prayer. We are your children, and we've gathered here today. We've gathered here to pray. Hear our cry. Oh Lord, we need your mercy, and we need your grace today. Hear us as we pray.
Don Moen there singing, and right at the end, his final phrase was, "Forgive us our sins." We're going to come in a moment to sharing communion. We hope you're going to do that as well at home. And the Bible tells us we have to examine ourselves when we come into communion. In other words, we can't go into the presence of a holy God unless, first of all, we confess the wrong that we've done. And we're going to be putting up on the screen in a moment some words of what are called the confession. I just want to say to you, don't say it unless you mean it. But if you mean it, we want you to encourage you to say it with us. So let's put up the words on the screen, can we? The words which are known as the confession. And if you feel comfortable, we want to encourage you at home to say them with us.
Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against your holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done. But you, O Lord, have mercy upon us, and grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life to the glory of thy holy name. Amen.
Amen. And so, Lord, we thank you for this bread and this wine. And we're reminded, as we're going to read in a moment, that your body was broken and your blood was shed in order that our sin could be forgiven. We come to you unworthy today, but we say, Lord, in our unworthiness, please take us. Grant us that forgiveness and that newness of life that only comes from you.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Amen.
And so let me read to you the words of the institution. For I received from the Lord that which also I delivered to you. That the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he'd given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
To this mystery, say, take this bread, take this wine. Now the sample made divine for any to receive. By your mercy we come to your table. By your grace you are making us faithful. Lord, we remember
the Lord Jesus Christ. We encourage all of you as part of the body of Christ to take the bread in remembrance that his body was broken for you. Lorna, body of Christ broken for you. Same manner, after supper, he took the cup and he said, this cup represents the new covenant that you have with me. The blood of the Lord Jesus Christ cleanses you from all sin. I encourage you to drink now. Lorna, blood of Christ shed for you.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. The blood of Jesus shed for you, Gordon. Communion table, I believe there is great healing for your body, your soul, and your spirit. I remember for about 5 years the Lord had me have communion every single day during my quiet time. I think it's such a special time. And now we're just going to bring all the prayers, people that are desperate to see God intervene in their lives. We're going to bring them to this communion table. The presence of the Lord is right here in this place, and He is right here with you wherever you're watching this morning. He says, "My presence will go with you." And I'm believing He's going to touch you this morning.
Amen. Let me just read out some of the emails that have been coming in. And when we read them out, let's just, in a sentence, pray for the people who've written and say, "Bless them, Lord, we ask, and heal them." At the beginning of a program, we heard from Kathleen. She asked for her friend Pat, starting dialysis, and Kathleen herself, who's suffering from carpal tunnel. Lord, hear her prayer, we pray.
Amen.
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 And then we received message that Bethany, just 11 years old, just had her tonsils out. She's feeling very sore. Lord, today, hear her prayer, we pray. Amen. And then here's someone, Lorna, who just said, no name. Please, can you pray for me so that I can start following the Lord?
I'm praying for you that the wooing of the Holy Spirit will just draw you to Jesus. His arms are open wide for you this morning. Just respond to Him and He will come in and take over your life.
Amen. And then this says, this program this morning is such a blessing. Lord, we pray blessings upon Philip in Northern Ireland and indeed for all of our viewers today. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. And then Barbara and John in Nottingham saying, not able to go out to church, but are sharing with us today. Lord, bless John and Barbara, we pray, in Nottingham, and all those who would like to be in a church today and can't because of the weather. Amen. And then we're asked to pray for Carol, who's got alcohol addiction and anxiety and self-esteem issues.
What's her name?
Carol.
I, in the name of Jesus, bind, in the name of Jesus, that spirit of addiction in Carol, and I surrender her to the Holy Spirit of God. And Father, I ask that you would do a work in Carol's life and deliver her from the evil one. Amen.
Amen. And some of you write into us almost on a weekly basis, and we're so glad you do that, because we need to be persistent in prayer. The scriptures teach us that. And one such person we hear often about is Jason, who suffers with MS. He's got a bad tummy today, feels quite sick. Lord, we pray and we bring Jason before you today in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. And then Wendy says that she had a bad car accident, suffering rejection, ill husband off work, bronchitis, so many issues, Lorna. I guess that in a sense she's symbolizing so many people whose life is in turmoil at this moment, yeah, and they don't know the peace.
So, Father, we ask for intervention into so many households that are in turmoil at this moment in time, through sickness, through loss of job, through shortage of money. Father, you are the one who knows and the one who sees and the one who answers when we cry out to you.
Amen. And Lord, we want to pray today for David's wife, Sylvia, who has pneumonia. Father, we just come against the blockage that she's feeling within her lungs. We pray release, and we pray, Father, that not only will she be able to breathe again, but that you'll totally heal her body. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. And then, Lorna, we've been looking at the pictures on the TV screen these past few days of Algeria, and our hearts have been going out to all the workers who've been there, the worry of the family. We think today of the pain and the grief that so many are feeling because their loved ones are not coming back.
And five still are unaccounted for, aren't they?
That's right. Lord, we thank you that you're a God who knows and sees all. And we cry out to you today for those feeling the pain, for those who are filled with worry and turmoil. We rejoice with those who rejoice, but we grieve with those who grieve. Lord, in your mercy, will you reach out to those families today? May they turn to you. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen.
Amen.
And then, Lorna, Doug, you went and saw him this week, didn't you?
Yeah, and how lovely it was to see Doug and Noemi, and we continue to pray for Doug. At the moment, his temperature over the night has risen, so we're praying that it will just go down, and we want to assure them how that we're thinking, we're praying for them, and we long for them back here on the television, speaking to all the viewers.
That's right. Noemi wrote and said this morning, our hearts sank a little bit when we took the temperature and found that it was slightly higher than it should be. So, Lord, we bring Doug before you. Yeah. And in a sense, he symbolises, Lord, for us all of those who are part of our family of Church Without Walls who are not well today. And, Lord, we just want to see a healing touch.
Amen.
Upon Doug and upon each and every person. Lord, you are the healer.
You are, Lord.
The scriptures tell us it's by your stripes, by your death, that we're healed. And we claim healing today for Doug.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. And then we want to bring one other situation before you. Let's put a picture up on the screen, can we, of a lovely lady. Here she is. This is a picture. I think it's just the back of her house in Colombia.
In August.
In August,
just in
this
August.
Picture. That's right. And just a few days ago, this lady was shot dead. Let me tell you her story, can I? It was 4 years ago, her husband became a Christian. He came so on fire for the Lord that he went down into his local village and town and began to talk about Jesus. And some terrorists there said to him, stop or we're going to kill you. He didn't stop. And 2 years ago, this lady's husband was murdered. The terrorists said to the lady and to her family, get out of this region or we'll kill you too. She didn't. And a few days ago, the terrorists came back and murdered this lady. Today, three children are left without a mum or a dad, all because, Lorna, they love the Lord Jesus Christ. We're asked to pray today for this lady's son, Hernan, who's 18, his sister, Rosmi, who's 9, and little Jacqueline, who's 6. They also have been told, get out, or we'll come back for you one by one. I almost feel, Lorna, like it's a letter for your post bag. What would you do in such a situation? Stay or go?
That 18-year-old has got a huge responsibility because she's the one that has got to make a decision for the other two children.
That's right. And so today, symbolising the whole church, which is persecuted around the world, we pray for Hernan, who's 18, Rosmi, who's 9, Jacqueline, who's 6. We feel their pain today.
Mm-hmm.
Their pain. And we pray that godly wisdom will be given to those who are counselling them. And we pray that you'll make strong so many who are witnessing in difficult and hard situations. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Amen.
There are so many more prayer requests that have come in. We're just going to pause for a few moments and listen to a lovely song which talks about softly and tenderly. And we're just going to continue to pray. And we encourage you at home, whatever your prayer needs are, as this song is played, why don't you just bring them before the Lord and say, Lord, in your mercy, hear my cry. Thank you.
I became a Christian 4 years ago. Before I became a Christian, I was involved in the occult. My friend and I used to play the Ouija board, and we had our fortunes told a few times, but it was harmless fun. I can't understand it, but every time I am in church these last few months, I get a pounding headache which lasts the day. Also, I am having awful nightmares. Am I right in thinking there is a link from my past? I thought when I became a Christian that everything became new, so I don't understand why this should happen. Is there any help you can give me? Yours, Janet. Janet, you're so right. Is it a link with my past? Yes, it is a link with your past, Janet. And you're right when you say when everything does become new. But first of all, I want to say to you, when you've walked into the devil's playground, he takes control of you. And let me tell you, he does not leave go of you that easily. And I would say there must be some unconfessed sin still in your life of what you did during your time, maybe on the Ouija board. Can I tell you, with the Ouija board, you speak with the devil himself. I've prayed with many people over the years that have been involved with the Ouija board, and the devil does hold on to you. And maybe even you're going to need some outside help. And the attack does come with bad headaches. And I'd just like to say to you, Janet, with a dandelion, you can cut off a dandelion and the dandelions will keep growing and keep growing. But if you get a dandelion at its root, then it will not grow again. So we maybe need to deal with some roots that are still there in your life. And I'd just like to share with you just a paragraph of a letter that I read. This girl had gone away from the Lord and had come back to the Lord, and she said, "I rededicated my life to Jesus Christ and I walked out a new creation. After that, every time I entered church, I would get a splitting headache. I would walk back to my car after each service, holding both sides of my head because the pain was so severe. This happened week after week. Sometimes people who have practiced witchcraft end up getting mind control spirit, which is what I said. But she went home one Sunday, absolutely desperate, and this is what she said, "With my face buried in my pillow, I began to pray. I went back as far as I could remember of and repented of everything. I was trembling in fear because of all that was going on around me. After I let everything out, I realized my headache was gone." Mm-hmm. Now, what do you think, Gordon?
I mean, maybe a practical thing that Janet needs to do is to make sure that she's got nothing to do with the occult left in her house. Mm. I remember having been a number of times to Africa for crusades. One of the things that the Africans do when they're coming to a Christian crusade is to bring along all the paraphernalia to do with witchcraft and any of the animism that they've been involved with before Christians. They put them in huge drums, oil drums, beside the stage where the crusade is taking place. And then during the meeting, they're all set alight, and the noise which goes up from the Africans at the joy of what they're seeing as destroying everything of the past. Mm. And that's what the Bible says in Acts 19 about the church at Ephesus. They brought out all their books and all their things to do with their past life, yeah, and burnt them. And I think Janet equally needs to make sure there's nothing in her house.
Like if she's still got the Ouija board or tarot cards.
Yeah, or books which do about the horoscope or anything to do like that.
Yes, yeah.
I mean, the other thing I'd just say, Lorna, is that on, I forget which night this week, but Doug Harris in Simply the Truth interviewed Michael Cummins, and it was a whole programme on deliverance. And it may well be that someone like Janice, or indeed anyone who's watching, who's struggling in this area, they may well find it helpful to get a copy of that tape so that they can listen to it. And that goes into it much more detail than obviously we can do this morning.
Yeah, and it is a huge subject, and I think there will be a lot of you out there that do need help. So I would encourage you to get the DVD. It's not just counselling. You may need deliverance from demons that Satan has put on you while you were walking in the occult.
If you've got an issue that you'd like us to raise, and of course we always preserve anonymity so we don't give the right name out on screen, then this is the way that you can write to Lorna.
On Sunday mornings during Church Without Walls, I deal with Lorna's postbag. And if you've got any issues or problems you'd like me to discuss on the programme, and I promise I will keep your name confidential, please write to me at lorna@revelationtv.com or to the address on the screen.
Well, thank you for your emails and texts that are flooding in. It's always great to hear from you. And even if we don't read them out during the programme, we still look at them after the programme has finished. Marion and Keith say, greetings, dear Gordon and Lorna. Thank you so much for Church Without Walls. We're at home from our fellowship due to snow and feel so blessed to be part of you. Thank you for lovely hymns. I was brought to Jesus through Just As I Am. And Pius, I hope that's the right way to pronounce your name, he says, please, can you pray for me, divine favour, as I renew my visa so that I will locate the channel that leads to my destiny. I want to experience peace and joy in the Lord. And Pius, we say amen to that. Jill says, thank God for you being there for us. Too icy to go out, so appreciated. It must be such a blessing to many. Bless you. Thank you, Jill. And this says, please pray for Georgia. She's so disappointed that she's too unwell to go to her own Sunday school today. She's got dizziness and a sore throat. It's a blessing she can meet with Church Without Walls this morning. Poor Georgia. Bless her, Lord, we pray. And Irene says, I'm due to leave hospital today after surgery, but it is snowing in France as well. Perhaps I'm here for a purpose. I cannot be with you today. God bless you. Well, we God bless you too, Irene. And pray for you in the hospital in France.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you both. Please pray that I'll have a closer walk with Jesus, also for my sons to return to him and Dawn to be born again.
So Lord, we pray that for all of us, that all of us day by day will walk closer to the Lord. The closer we walk to him, the more we will hear him.
Amen. And even if we don't read out your prayer alerts, we'll be showing them with our intercessors so that we can continue to pray. Mary says, please pray for my adult son David, suffering from complications of pancreatitis. Please also pray for him to have an experience of God's presence. And here's somebody who's talking about a revival alert for Plymouth. I don't know about that, but we do pray for revival for Plymouth and Manchester and Bristol and every city throughout the United Kingdom we long to see. And here's Lawrence, who's asking prayer for his sister in her application to the Home Office. And Lorna, here's someone, I guess it echoes what so many people would pray. Kim says, please will you pray for my husband Ralph? He's worked for his employer for the last 25 years. The company are really down, refrigeration and air conditioning. As he's in charge of sales, he's really being put under so much pressure, it makes me weep. Father, we pray for so many today who are in work situations where there's a real threat of redundancy and enough work coming in. We pray, Lord, particularly for Ralph and that firm, that you'll cause blessing to come upon them and that you'll enable Ralph, Lord, to just find the right contacts to increase for sales. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen.
Amen.
Well, in a moment I want to share God's word with you. He is a faithful God, that's the promise, and he does want to speak to each one of us. As we prepare ourselves to hear God's word, let's listen to Robin Mark singing Faithful God.
Faithful One, so
so unchanging.
Faithful God. He is a faithful God. So unchanging. So no matter what circumstances you are going through, He will be faithful, and He is faithful. So trust Him. there are just so many of you going through so much, and I am feeling for you. Even with the weather, I feel so spoiled because we're in Spain and I'm looking at the snow and I'm hearing from my family how they're struggling to get to work, and driving and everything is so difficult. But I just want you to know we are standing with you, and we're standing with you in your sicknesses as well. And I just look forward now to Gordon opening the scriptures to us in Psalm 23, and I know we're going to be blessed, because in Psalm 23 it's where David finds a place of rest with the Lord.
I'm going to read just together some scriptures before I bring the word of God. It's our passage is going to be out of Luke. I'm going to go back into Psalms in a moment, but here's Luke chapter 12 and starting to read at verse 16, where it says, "Then he spoke a parable to them, saying, the ground of a certain rich man yielded plenty. And he thought within himself, saying, what shall I do, since I have no room to store my crops? So he said, I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build greater, and there I will store all my crops and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have many good things laid up for many years. Take your ease, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, fool, this night your soul will be required of you. Then whose will those things be which you have provided? So is he who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God." I pray that the Lord will bless that reading and us as we go in now to hearing God's word. Hi, welcome back. I want to meditate for a few moments this morning on the theme of rest. Let me share some words with you. Sorry, can we just stop a sec? Every time that I mention, read Psalm 23, verse 2 and 3, will you put them up on the screen? It's almost only verse 2 I concentrate on, so it's only verse 2 you need to put up. All right. Okay, let's start again. I want us to meditate for a few moments this morning on some lovely words that are very familiar with you. Let me just share them with you. They're found in Psalm 23 and verse 2. There it is. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. As I look at those words and think about them, if there's one word that sums them up, it's the word rest. When we think of rest, what we normally think of is sitting down, putting our feet up, having a sleep maybe. But for the Christian, rest is part of our Christian maturity as we learn what it is to rest in the Lord Jesus Christ. It's said that Hudson Taylor, who was the founder of the China Inland Mission and did an amazing work in China, that whenever he was faced with difficult situations, and they were often in the work that he was doing and the work that his colleagues was doing, he used to begin to sing quietly a hymn that was written by Gene Piggott, which said, "Jesus, I am resting in the joy of who you are. I'm finding out the greatness of thy loving heart." And those who know him say that often when telegrams had come in and messages had come in to say that some particular mission outstation that was going through a difficult time, that Hudson Taylor would get up at 2-3 in the morning and they'd hear in the compound the harmonium playing away. And what would he be playing? "Jesus, I am resting." So you see, resting isn't just simply about sitting down and doing nothing. It's about in the midst of trouble and difficulty and tasks that we find almost impossible, is saying, "Lord, I'm resting and trusting in you." was a famous poem by somebody called Wilfred Arlen Peterson, entitled Slow Me Down, Lord. And the first verse says, slow me down, Lord, ease the pounding of my heart by the disquiet, by the quietening of my mind, steady my hurried pace with a vision of the eternal reach of time. And one of the other verses says, give me amidst the confusion of the day the calmness of the everlasting hills. Break the tensions of my nerves and muscles with the soothing music of the singing streams that live in my memory. For all the gadgets that we have today, the laptops, the iPads, the computers, the Blackberries, the mobile phones, which are all supposed to help us to do things, we actually live in a society that is getting more and more rushed. I've been reading a book just lately by Christine Dark, who has a program here on Revelation TV called Exploits. And in the book, she says, Muslims are family orientated, but often at home and have time to chat. Unlike our frenzied Western lifestyles, when families are no longer together and no longer eat meals together, Arab hospitality, she said, commands that they spend time with each other. I thought I'd look up and find some quotes from people to see how they describe their lifestyle. I was amazed the way that constantly the idea of rushing and stress and all the things that needed doing kept coming up. Here's some quotes. I can get very impatient, says somebody, when things aren't moving fast enough. Do you relate to that? What about very task-orientated, focused sometimes to the detriment of others? And how about this one? I like everything to be done as practically and as efficiently as possible, and don't like to waste time, because time is all we have. And one more. It's an irony, says somebody, of our modern lives, that while technology is continually inventing things that save us time, we use that time to do more and more things. And so our lives are more fast-paced and hectic than ever. And what happens is, because we're doing more and more things, we don't have time for ourselves, and we don't have time for our families, and we don't have time for the Lord, apart from just a few snatched times that are rushed in his presence. And because of that, we don't have rest, and we don't have contentment, and we don't have calmness of our soul and spirit. But Jesus says to us this morning, come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He says, take my yoke upon me and learn upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. That's what the psalmist is saying when he said those words in Psalm 23 verse 2, where he says, he makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. If there's one word that sums up all that I've said so far, it's the word rest. Now, to understand Psalm 23, we need to understand really a little bit of the background to it in the scriptures. If our psalms were placed in the right order, then Psalm 23 would come immediately after Psalm 3, 4, 5, and 6, because that's historically where they fit in. And we're talking about events that are found in 2 Samuel chapter 17 and chapter 18. There'd been big family breakdowns in King David's family. Absalom, his son, had usurped David for the throne. Absalom had gone to Hebron, and there he'd encouraged the people to proclaim him as king. And now David was having to flee out of Jerusalem with a band of faithful followers.
David had no choice but to retreat into the wilderness. And we read about how he crossed the Kidron River. He heads south, a bit risky because south was towards Hebron, but at some point he turns round and begins to go in a northeasterly direction. All the time looking back, wondering if Absalom and his followers were going to come after him and seek to kill him or take him prisoner. When David awoke on his first morning in the wilderness, he thought that his morning prayer was Psalm 3. Lord, how they have increased who trouble me, it begins. They certainly had. Another long day lay ahead of David as he escapes from Jerusalem, all the time thinking that there was going to be that cloud of dust behind him, meaning that Absalom and the troops were coming after him. He fled as hard as he could. It's thought that that next day, by evening time, he was writing and using as his prayers Psalm chapter 4, where he says, I lie down in peace and sleep for you, O Lord, who make me dwell in safety. The next day he's up, he's off again. This time he's getting into what would be called bandit territory. David was used to being a guerrilla in the sense that he spent many years in the wilderness, but now he'd be weary from all the travel. They wanted to put as much distance as they could between them and Hebron. And we find in Psalm 5 and verses 2 and 3, he says, my voice you shall hear in the morning, O Lord. In the morning I will direct to you. At some point in the next 24 hours, David was in despair about what had happened. He'd lost his throne. He'd lost his family. All the things that he'd had were gone. He cries out to the Lord and he says in Psalm 6, O Lord, hear me, for my bones are troubled. My soul is greatly troubled. I'm weary with my groaning. I drench my couch with my tears. My eyes waste away because of my grief. David certainly was a man in trouble. I wonder this morning, do you have troubles? Have you got situations that you think are so difficult that you don't know the way forward? And you certainly can't find rest and contentment because you're worrying so much about them? David was exactly someone like that. His family divided, his throne gone, all the pleasures that he enjoyed in Jerusalem taken away from him. He was hounded and hunted. And yet, the next psalm that David writes, out in the wilderness as a hunted warrior, is the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. As he sought the Lord, the burden, the troubles, the distress gave way to peace and calmness and stillness. And my longing and my prayer is that whatever the situations that you're in today, right now, that in amongst them all, you'll know the calmness and the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm reminded of that story of when the Lord was sailing across the lake with the disciples, and Jesus was in the boat and he was tired and he lay down and he went to sleep, and the disciples, they were getting the boat over to the other side, and a great storm came. And the disciples thought that somehow they were going to drown and not make it to the other side, even though they were seasoned fishermen. And they woke Jesus up. And they said to Jesus, don't you care? Don't you care that we might drown? And Jesus stands and he raises his hand or whatever he did, and he commanded the sea to be still and the winds to stop. And a calm and a peace came over it. That story was told to a group of children on one occasion. And it happened to be a day when there was a lot of snow and a lot of ice, and the school broke up early. And the teacher was helping the children to make sure that they got home safely through the wind and the rain and the snow that was falling. And one little boy was heard telling to another one of the children out of his class, we could do with that chap Jesus right now to help us to get home. In amidst the storm that you're in, Jesus wants to come and say, peace, be still, and for you to find rest for your soul. For the majority of adults, life is so exhausting. We've just had the hecticness of Christmas. I looked at those queues of people who were queuing to get into the shops on New Year's Day. I couldn't believe it. The panic, the rush to get in and to buy things. And now it's trying to see through to the end of January and payday so that we can buy some more things. We're a society which says rush, 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 panic, 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 anxiety, anxiety, anxiety. The psalmist's life was equally stressed, equally traumatic, but he found a key to rest and tranquility. A number of years ago, Lorna and I rented a house next to a farm in Cheshire. And it was a part of Cheshire where in the winter time the sheep were taken into the barn and then released in the morning so that they could graze on the grass again. And I can remember on a number of mornings watching the sheep coming out, and they'd begin to come out and they'd all go in a straight line following each other, and then they'd begin to just scatter and to munch away at the grass. And if a couple of hours later I looked out of the window again at the field where the sheep were in, I would see them sitting down content with what they'd had to eat. They were still surrounded by the luxurious grass, but they were just content to lie there. The shepherd hadn't had to come along and to say, right, sheep, you've had 2 hours of feeding. It's time now for you to stop and to lie down. They did it by instinct. And we as Christians need to learn that there comes a time when we have to be content with what God has given us and rest and lie in his presence. Our mentality is to fill our time and to be busy planning and scheming and thinking, where's the next meal going to come from? Where's the next money going to come from? What do we need so that we can spend some more things? Jesus tells the story of a farmer who had filled his barns with crops. And the farmer said, I need bigger crops so that I can put more belongings into them. Soul, you have many goods laid up for many years, says the farmer. So then you'll be able to take your ease, eat, drink, and be merry. And what does God say to him? God says, fool, this night your soul is required of you. Jesus' words to his disciples are, do not worry about life, what you eat or what you drink, nor about your body, what you'll put on. It is not life more than food, and body more than clothing. Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather in barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not more valuable than them? The psalmist said, he makes me lie down in green pastures. Maybe for some of us today, the Lord is saying, look, I long for you to lie down in green pastures. Not so that you're going to come with a shopping list of things that you want to tell me about, but just so that you can stop and listen to me, because I want to reveal things to you. The Lord longs to speak into our heart and into our life. The Lord longs to give us dreams. The Lord longs to give us visions. The Lord longs that he might speak into each one of our hearts and just give us that peace and that contentment that can only come from him. No phones, no computers, no laptops, just coming into his presence with him so that we build our relationship and we learn to be content in him. My challenge to you today is, are you resting in God? Have you learned yet to be content with him and him alone? Are you able to lie down in green pastures and not to worry about all the things that are going on around you, but to leave them with the Lord? He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. May you know that rest and that joy in his presence. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Everybody needs a little help sometimes. No one stands alone. Makes no difference if you're just a child like me or a king upon a throne. For there are no exceptions. We all stand in the line. Everybody needs a friend. Let me tell you of mine. He's my forever friend. My leave me never friend. From darkest nights to rainbows end, he's my forever friend. Even when I turn away, he cares for me. His love no one can shake. Even as I walk away, he's by my side. With every breath I take. And sometimes I forget. My halo fails to shine.
Well, our time, unfortunately, this morning has gone. We can't even hear all of Charlie Lansborough singing Forever Friend. That's what Jesus is, isn't it?
A forever friend, one that we can totally depend on.
I want to say thank you to all of you who've been sending us emails and texts this morning. We love hearing from you. We'll read every single one. Let me just read this one from Marlene, who says, it's so good to be with you on this snowy morning, unable to get to church due to ice. It's wonderful to be able to sit and take in the love of the Lord Jesus, which you feel portrayed into your home. That's what our desire is, that you just meet Jesus. And I pray that during this week you'll know him. In your goings out and in your comings in. Well, Lorna, it's about time for us to finish. We've got about 30 seconds left.
All right. Well, bless you for joining us with Church Without Walls. It's been lovely.